Educational Communications and this station present Environmental Directions with Nancy Perlman. On this series, we explore the effects of human influence on the Earth's ecosystems and discuss solutions to environmental problems which affect the quality of life on this planet. Environmental Directions gives you the kind of information you need to help you participate in decisions impacting your community, the nation, and the world. Now, here's your host, Nancy Perlman.
Hello, my guest is Jeremy Iversen. He is an actor and best-selling author of the Simon & Schuster book, High School Confidential. He is also a member of the Baha'i Faith, as well as being a Phi Beta Kappa graduate of Stanford University with dual degrees in international relations and political science. Welcome. It's a pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you so much, Nancy. It's wonderful to be on the show.
We're going to talk about how your religion cares about the environment, about peoples, and humanity's place with the natural ecosystem. But I think we have to begin with who are people who believe as you do, because there are only about 7 million followers of your religion.
Absolutely. So I'm happy to tell you a little bit about the Baha'i Faith. We are the second most widespread religion in the world, and we are the fastest growing religion in the world. The one sentence cliff note summary of our faith is that it is the emerging global religion of social and spiritual transformation. And so what we mean by that is we see religion as being one. We see there as being one God. We see there as being one humanity. And we believe that one religion is revealed in chapters over time. As humanity continues to evolve, it's ready for more and more advanced teachings and a more complete vision of reality and of its own place within our universe.
The original teachings were really provided by your founder, your prophet, in the 1800s.
Yes, so we believe that the most recent update to religion was provided by the founders of our faith 175 years ago. And we believe that the essential core of that message is for humanity to come together on a global scale to create a unified, peaceful, and happy world.
I think we need that now to protect humans and all the other animals and plants on the planet from the disastrous climate change that's going on, from people overpopulating and destroying ecosystems and habitats. And I know we were on a hike in the mountains, and you were telling me that since the 1970s, one-third of the U.S. bird populations have become extinct?
Absolutely. So what we see is, you know, we believe that humanity received a message about what we should do to have a much better world. And it's up to us as humans to either follow that message or turn away from it. And if we turn away from it, God's purpose is greater than our own. And so it will come to be even without our almost willing it, in a sense. So we were told 175 years ago that all of Earth needs to come together to create a type of global assembly where we can see humanity as one and we can make decisions for the planet together as one human community. Instead, humans ignored that, and we decided we're going to keep on having our borders and our anthems and our wars and our nationalisms. And so we, of course, ended up with the two most deadly wars in human history. We ended up with certain ideological movements like communism that saw the deaths of over 50 million people. And now we see coming up climate change, which is, of course, a problem that cannot be addressed on a national level. There's one environment. There's one atmosphere. The atmosphere doesn't stop at a border. And so again, by humanity continuing to ignore the idea that this is one unified globe, it's incapable of addressing a problem that has to be dealt with on a global level.
And I was reading some of the scriptures that you believe in, and they were talking about unity, and they were talking about our place with the other flora and fauna on the planet, that we have evolved, but we still have to remember all the other life and take care of them. Is there a particular statement from your founder that is a guiding principle?
Well, we have a lot of statements, and we also believe that we have continued guidance through our faith, which continues to release statements about the vital role that humanity plays in preserving our environment. One quote that I really like from the founder of our faith is Baha'u'llah is the founder of our faith, and he has a quote that nature is God's will and its expression in and through the contingent world. I believe there's another quote that says that nature is essentially a mirror or reflection of God. We have a lot of organic metaphors where nature is essentially seen almost like a physical body, and every part is interdependent and everything depends upon all the other components, much as a human body does. And this is true even on a universal scale. And so like a body that is sick, it's important for medicine to be delivered appropriately in order to heal its issues and problems. And as the sort of most evolved form on Earth right now, we have a special stewardship to the environment and to this creation that we are part of and a reflection of God within.
I have interviewed people from other faiths, other religious, spiritual belief systems, and in each one, they do believe that we have to protect nature, that humans have to live together with the other life forms. And some of them have certain practices, certain ceremonies or traditions. There's one in the Jewish faith where they plant trees every year, and that's extremely important. Do you have any of those kinds of activities with the Baha'i Faith?
One of the most important things for us is that we don't try to have set forms and rituals, because we believe those become fossilized and take people away from direct experience and reflection of God. But, you know, we do have certain practices, like we have fasting and we have daily prayer. And those things depend upon positions of the sun and cycles of nature. So we're intimately bound up into the process of the cosmos in that sense. Also, you know, all of our reflections, our meditations, and our prayers are designed to impel us to action in this world in order to help enhance, preserve, and build the kingdom of God on earth, really.
And you do have certain holidays that you celebrate. I remember going to the New Year's celebration, which was actually in the springtime.
That's right. Our New Year's is actually on the vernal equinox, which is the first day of spring, which is another example of how the faith is intimately bound up in the rhythms of nature and of the heavenly bodies in that sense.
Most religions do have food as a critical element, but it's different. Hindus do not eat cows. Christians will eat cows. Jews and Muslims won't eat pork. Sikhs are vegetarian. Does it make a difference what you eat or not eat, other than your occasional fasting?
Well, we have very specific guidance about that we need to show kindness and love toward animals. So right now, we are allowed to eat meat because, again, consider the global environment. There's still a lot of people who live in situations of food insecurity, and to take away an incredibly important source of protein and sustenance for them, like animals, wouldn't necessarily be the most appropriate thing at this time. However, our guidance does foresee potentially transitioning to a more vegetarian way of eating. And in fact, we don't think we're the end of religion. We think there will be more guidance coming in the future. We think that there's a continuing, infinite succession of manifestations of God who will continue to deliver guidance as humanity continues to evolve. So unlike, I think, any other religion, we don't see ourselves as the end or the final truth. We just see ourselves as another most relevant truth for this day and age in one ever-evolving global religion.
Most religions were created decades ago, centuries ago, millennia ago. They've evolved. Indigenous people have their connection to nature in a different way than the mainstream religions. But none of them dealt with what we have to face now, and that is the pollution through petrochemicals, through our exploitation of the resources, everything from pesticides and herbicides to other kinds of technological, we say advances, but they're sort of not advances the way they're destroying the environment. How do we deal with some of these modern problems?
We actually had expressly within our teachings from 174 years ago that God was about to release into the world a type of science and arts and crafts that nobody had ever before even begun to be able to conceptualize. And so the first person in our faith was born in 1820. And if you look at global GDP, which is gross domestic product, it's essentially flat from the dawn of civilization in about 10,000 before the Common Era until 1820, at which point everything skyrockets upward because there's the Industrial Revolution. Within the same day that our founder enunciated the fact that, you know, there was a new revelation from God, the first telegraph was sent, which said, "What hath God wrought?" So at the same coincident, at the exact same time as the birth of our faith, was the birth of globalized communication technology and new industrial processes that potentiate the development and growth of enormous amounts of wealth. At the same time, it's a tool, and a tool is value neutral. Technologies are value neutral. It all depends upon how we ourselves employ them. So all of these technologies can be used for good or they can be used for ill. And those things depend upon what our spiritual state is and the social systems that we build around that spiritual state.
Nuclear power is a perfect example.
We actually have a quote, and I wish I could remember it perfectly from memory, but it says something like, this is again from the founder of our faith, strange and extraordinary things exist hidden within the earth that are not yet understood by the minds of men. Were they to be used poorly, they would contaminate the environment and the atmosphere, and the pollution would be uncalculable. And this was, of course, written before anybody had yet dug up uranium and done anything with it. So, you know, all these things were, as far as we're concerned, anticipated. And it's just, again, how we use them. So when you talk about environmental degradation through petrochemical spills, for example, that's embedded within a type of greed, money-seeking system that's only serving to increase shareholder value at the decrease of having a global environment and a community of love and peace and friendship.
Almost every spiritual belief system, whether or not it's animistic from indigenous people around the world to polytheistic religions to monotheistic religions, have sacred sites. Ancient places could include mountain peaks and other natural areas. And then people started developing buildings and temples, whether or not it's the Acropolis in Athens to the ancient Greek gods or the modern structures. And I know that your faith has some beautiful architecture. Is it considered sacred or just a nice place to reflect on the teachings?
It's sacred insofar as it is related to our worship of God. But in and of itself, we believe part of our revelation was that every single particle of the universe is able to reflect forth God. And that is the same for any particle of the universe. It's the same for your garden shed. It's the same for the shopping mall. Like, every particle of the universe reflects forth God. That is what it means, that nature is God's expression in the contingent world. And so our holy sites that we have are only holy insofar as they are related to the faith. We say, blessed is the spot. And we have a whole prayer, which again, I try to remember. But it's like, blessed is the spot and the place and the hill and the mountain and the valley and the stream and the meadow and the heart and the home, you know, where mention of God is made and his praise is glorified. So any spot, including you right now, your room right now, or your car right now, if you're listening in your car, is holy and transfigured by God as soon as you become aware of that.
Do you have a thought that you can leave us with from your teachings?
Here's a nice quote that I like that stresses the importance of unity, which is one of our key principles. We need to come together on a global scale to address these issues. And within your community, we need unity. We need to put the unity into community. That's not the quote. That's just something I said right now and realized that it rhymed. Here's an actual quote, though, from one of our central figures, which is that all beings, whether universal or particular, were created perfect and complete from the beginning. The most one can say is that the perfections only become apparent gradually. The law of God is one, the evolution of existence is one, and the divine order is one. And so what we're doing is we're seeing the increase of these perfections, and it's our job not to take our hands off the steering wheel, but rather to make sure that we're able to guide this ship of civilization, this ship of progress, toward that end of peace and unity that sees the environment as a reflection of the sacred and humanity as a reflection of the sacred as well within that mosaic.
Obviously, we don't have time to have you share all the teachings. I don't know how many pages there really are.
There's about 100,000 pages.
So you've read one quote, you've presented a few other short segments, but I know religions generally have symbols that reflect them. Are yours plant life, the animal life, the stars?
We think that every human has within themselves the sign of God. And the sign of God is that transcendent function within you that connects you to something higher and beyond you, and that everything within it has the sign of God. And so every single thing is a holy symbol and is a reflection of God.
It sounds as though, even though the basic original teachings were written a while back, they are still relevant today. What is the guiding principle that you use to be an environmental activist, to try and stop climate change, to try and save the animals and plants from becoming extinct, to try and protect the wilderness.
I would essentially see our teachings from the future, because they basically, most of them were so ahead of their time and are continued to be ahead of their time. I mean, we have principles like the harmony and unity of science and religion, that there should be no prejudice of any kind, racial, gender, class-based, that women and men are equal, all that sort of thing. And these things are still not remotely put into practice in our world. We specifically say we need one language as a means of international communication. We need to have one global assemblage. And so we still have 800 more years, as far as we're concerned, to try to put these things into practice. These are teachings from the future. That's what these are.
Well, let's not wait the 800 years. Let's hope that we can start making some of the changes now, because we don't have a lot of time with climate change and animals and plants becoming extinct. We've got to stop that. But I want to thank you so much for giving us some guidance from your perspective, from your belief system. Thank you for being my guest.
Thank you so much for having me, Nancy. It's wonderful the work that you do with this show.
I have been speaking with Jeremy Iversen. He is an actor and best-selling author and a member of the Baha'i Faith. We'll be back in a moment with more ecological issues.
Environmental Directions with Nancy Perlman continues with further discussion of the world's critical ecological issues. For more information, you may call 310-559-9160 or go to www.ecoprojects.org. Now, here's Nancy.
With me is Dieuwertje Kast. She is the STEM Programs Manager of the University of Southern California's Joint Educational Project. She has many degrees in marine biology, master's in arts and teaching, and she is an awardee of the Ford's 30 Under 30 in Science. Welcome. It's a pleasure to have you with us.
Likewise. Thank you for having me, Nancy.
Your organization has received an AGU Centennial Grant to provide augmented reality sandbox training in low-income schools. What is augmented reality sandbox in relationship to the earth sciences?
The augmented reality sandbox, as it sounds, it is a sandbox. We've just made it a slightly more techy. And so what we do is we have an Xbox 360 Kinect, which is a device that is probably in a lot of households that have an Xbox themselves. You can reprogram it to be a 3D scanner. And so it's actually scanning in the heights of all of the sand, and then it converts it to a program that's running a bathymetry model. So the lowest level is usually blue. Let's say it's 1 inch. Then everything that's around 1 inch tall will be blue. And then 2 inches is the next layer up will be green. The next layer up will be yellow, orange, red. And you can even make snow-capped mountains.
I'm thinking of the sandbox, and I'm seeing an example where you have sand, different colors, and with the sweep of a hand, you can change the position of the lakes, the mountains. You can show how the different geological features can interact.
That is exactly what we do with our augmented reality sandbox. We use it to teach concepts relating to weathering, deposition, erosion. We have students be the sources of erosion, so wind and water, to actually be able to move the sand around. And so we demonstrate how those factors change the landscapes. There's also what I call a making it rain program. And so if you make the shape of your hand on top of the sand where the Xbox can scan your hand in, it will rain underneath your hand. And so when it rains underneath your hand, whatever shapes that you have there, it will actually travel down the watershed. And so students can also see how does the local geography or like geology of an area move water around and impact it as well.
I remember playing with some of these at different science museums, mm-hmm. where they show the wave actions, they show the river action, as you say, how the watershed impacts the river, impacts the land around. What are we to learn from moving the sand around?
My job at the Joint Educational Project as the STEM Programs Manager is to find innovative ways of really translating some of these concepts, and in particular right now, these earth science-based concepts, into an activity where the students or teachers, I also teach teachers, where they are really integrated into the lesson, and that it's very hands-on and that's participatory. And so really being able to immerse themselves in this augmented reality system and visualize what's going on with these different earth science concepts, because some of these are very complicated. Erosion, like, what is erosion and what does that mean to an elementary school student? What is weathering? What is deposition? These are really intense vocabulary words. And so if we can translate that into a more like hands-on and participatory experience, the students will take more of those ideas home with them.
Obviously, people need to understand the processes of how our weather, our water, our soil, our air all function and interact together. This is just basic science. I learned it decades ago. You've learned it more recently, but there's a component that I didn't learn in elementary school or in high school, and that is the impact of human beings on the planet and how we are affecting the changes that are causing climate change, that are causing ecosystem disruption and causing wildlife extinction. So how do you take this basic science and put it into our modern context of environmental science and the knowledge that we need to have to protect our ecological resources?
That's a great question. Our entire STEM program is aligned to the next generation science standards. And a lot of these new science standards that are up and coming into the schools now are not only that they build, they have similar themes throughout grades, but they also focus on human impact on the environment. And so the curriculum that we're creating around these augmented reality sandbox does have a human impact piece. And so we are 3D printing little like structures and towns that the students can actually build into the sandbox itself. And then while using their own forces, whether they be the sources of erosion, deposition, or weathering, seeing how the change in landscape affects those different places. So like if one of them happens to be a waterway, what happens with sea level rise, and like simulating concepts like that.
The American Geophysical Union is a global community of over 60,000 earth and space scientists. They have established these grant programs. How many students do you plan to reach?
We're planning to reach 2,400 students in 7 schools per year, many of whom are low-income and underrepresented minority students, but specifically they're underrepresented in the earth and space sciences.
And the goal seems to be to inspire the world to see how earth and space science can create a more sustainable future for all of us. That sustainability is the main factor, isn't it?
Always is and always should be.
You have a BS in biology, an MS in marine biology. You have a master's degree in teaching. These degrees, when you've been studying them recently, have they incorporated the current ecological crisis in the basic information of what's out there in the oceans, what's out there on the land?
Some of them definitely have. I think both the biology and the marine biology degree focus on these major changes to our planet, the human causes behind a lot of them, and also kind of setting up the infrastructure to try and see what you can do about it. I want them to know that them and their students can be part of the solution when it comes to these different environmental issues. The augmented reality sandbox is one example. We also have another grant where we're setting up Arduino carbon dioxide sensors so we can actually measure like atmospheric carbon input from each of the different schools that we work with.
You received an award for the Forbes 30 Under 30 in Science. Obviously, you're under 30 years old. You're also a woman in science. Who was your competition?
Actually, I was very surprised that I received this in 2016 because I was nominated and won in the science category for my work in STEM education.
Let's define STEM because that's an abbreviation.
Yes. So STEM stands for science, technology, engineering, and math.
And not too many women are in that.
That is rather unfortunate. Not only women, but also people of color. So as the STEM programs manager of the Joint Educational Project, there are 2 main programs under my jurisdiction. One of them is Wonder Kids. Wonder Kids is an after-school STEM career program. And so we focus on different fields of STEM every semester. Based on those fields, we write hands-on curriculum, introducing main ideas in those fields. And then we bring in scientists that are in those fields to come in and talk. And all of the programs that I work with facilitate programming to low-income students of color. And so we highly prioritize bringing in scientists of color and women whenever possible so that they can really see themselves represented in the people that we put in front of them. This semester, we have a little bit of funding from the Norris Cancer Center. And so a lot of our units are very medically themed. So we're doing pulmonology or lungs, audiology or earing, because yes, you can get ear cancer. We're doing emergency services and orthopedics.
So many different units. And of course, there's so many different aspects of the environment that can be incorporated in this kind of STEM program. But I'm intrigued to find out more about what you've done in ocean education, because even though you grew up in the United States, you were born in the Netherlands in Europe. The Dutch are very famous for controlling the ocean to the point of building those dikes so that they could create more land. And a lot of that country is lower than sea level.
Yes, I know that is definitely one of the qualms of living in the Netherlands. But there's so much science that has gone into trying to protect the country, and which is why the Netherlands is at the forefront of a lot of this, because they have a lot of the foresight to see this is going to really negatively impact our country.
They really don't want sea level rise.
They really don't, because it's such a small country and a lot of it could easily be wiped out because it's so under sea level.
How does something like a STEM program tackle some of the issues? For example, we are hearing so much about plastics in the ocean, and then the wildlife is suffering because they're eating the plastics. But we also have the same problem with the land mammals, where they are suffering in many different ways due to pesticides and herbicides and other kind of pollution and human destruction. Can STEM incorporate those earth sciences?
Most definitely. And the augmented reality sandbox that AGU has funded, so AGU is the American Geophysical Union, with this grant that we've gotten from them, we can tackle some of those issues, because these augmented reality sandboxes are set up like watersheds. And so when we get more into depth with this curriculum, some of them, we do drop different items that will simulate either pesticides or plastics actually traveling down in the watershed, because it's very hard for some of our students to really visualize like what I'm doing here. If I'm consuming this plastic bottle, what actually happens to it? You know, or if I throw something on the street, does it matter? Will this end up in the ocean? Like, there's a disconnect between how the watershed functions and how something that they do as an individual can really impact the planet, because it will travel, it make its way through the whole watershed. And so we simulate those ideas with the sandbox itself.
What is the most difficult environmental issue to present through this augmented reality sandbox?
I think the hardest one in general with the sandbox would be climate change, because there are so many inputs that cause climate change, whether it's burning of fossil fuels or cutting down more trees, etc. Some of those, just the input and the changes that happen, like increasing carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, having that make carbonic acid in the ocean, and that causes ocean acidification.
Can any teacher just get four pieces of wood and get some sand and make their own sandbox?
I wish, and that is kind of what we're hoping to do, is we're really hoping to set up all of the instructions and what you'd need to be able to create a sandbox.
I want to thank you so very much for educating our young people about basic science as well as current ecological issues and the environmental sciences. And thank you for being my guest.
Thank you so much for having me, Nancy. I really appreciate the time you've taken for this interview. I wanted to thank the American Geophysical Union for the centennial grant that it has offered us to the STEM program, so that we're able to facilitate this augmented reality sandbox. And we're going to be installing them in 7 low-income schools in Los Angeles. And we're working with the teachers to actually be able to teach them to use it so that they can use it with their students.
Thank you. I have been speaking with Dieuwertje Kost. She is the STEM Programs Manager at the University of Southern California's Joint Educational Project. I'm Nancy Perlman. Thank you very much for joining us, and do tune in again next week.
If you would like free information about these environmental issues, go to www.ecoprojects.org or call 310-559-9160. Environmental Directions with your host, Nancy Perlman, is a community affairs program of the nonprofit organization Educational Communications and this station.